Good morning, welcome to EduSat Network. Friend, today we are going to discuss an important topic, and the topic is little bit different from the generally we discuss in regular lectures, and basically on the thought process we will try to understand how do we think, how do people think, what are the different categories of thinking, what are the types, and thinking and think thought process, how interlinked, how one can predict about the or you can say you all know that philosophers think differently, intellectuals think differently, thinkers have their own view. So we'll try to understand today lecture the thinking process and thought process. And for discussion on this very topic, we have in the studio Dr. M.N. Thakur. He himself is a political science thinker, and he is presently associate professor of political science center for political science studies in Jawaharlal Nehru University, a premier university of the country. And he regularly writes in different newspapers and magazines on the different issues, political, social issues. So I think his knowledge and experience will help us to understand this topic and will give a kind of insight how we can improve our thinking process. So on your behalf, I welcome him for the EduSat lecture on this very topic. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, Amranji. I think this is a very, very interesting topic that we are going to share today. More reflective ideas on this topic would be more interesting than anything very concrete and crystallized. So what we'll do is, we will think together, we'll think while we are talking. And this is a difficult process, because if you look for coherence in this process, you may not get a lot of coherence, but the aim of the topic, aim of the discussion would be to provoke you to think. That's the point. One of the famous philosophers called Heidegger, Martin Heidegger, has made a very interesting point. He has written a book called What is Called Thinking. And he makes the point that the most difficult thing is to think. We are thinking beings. No doubt that the basic difference between the human beings and the animals. What is the difference? The difference is that we are supposed to be thinking being. We can raise structures in our imagination, and then we can create those things in the real world. So no other living being probably has produced so much of collective consciousness. The amount of knowledge, what you call knowledge, is the accumulation of collective consciousness of the human civilization. This has been produced by them, this has been accumulated by them, and this is transferred by human beings to the next generation. So through our education, through our everyday life, through our sharing with various means, we transfer that knowledge to the new generation. So this is the capacity to think that human beings do have. But Do we think? This is a big question that Heidegger really raises. He says that what we basically do is we acquire certain ideas from society, and then we think that this is our thought. In fact, this is just a reflection of what is being already thought in society. So thought process is not an easy thing to capture. It's a process. It is not fixed thing. Generally, what happens when we are given the textbooks, we are given the books, these are crystallized thoughts of somebody else. And when we acquire that, that is just transfer of that knowledge to us. Have we contributed to that thinking or not? This is the question that we must raise. How many times do we think? Even our students and the professors who are in the business of thinking, in the business of creating new knowledge, in the business of transferring this knowledge, how far do we think? Do we create new things? Are we creative enough or not? This is a question that we have to raise. So what I'm going to do today is, I'm going to divide my discussion in three parts. The first part will be about how do we, as conscious being, how do we think about the world? And what are the categories through we think? And I'll try to demonstrate that there are different layers of our being and different layers of our being in the world through which we think. And it depends how we grow in our thinking process, that how much do we capture what is our limit of thinking? This is a very, very interesting question. I will come to that. The second thing that I will do is, I will take up one or two examples. I will take one example of the idea of liberation. What do you mean by liberation? How far can we think about liberation? And the third point I will make is, I will take some philosophers to demonstrate how have they thought, what has been their limits of thought, and how far have they been able to think beyond the boxes, how far they have been able to think beyond certain point. So this is how we will construct our discussion today. So let me come to the first point that I am making. Who are we? So what is our specific quality, and how do we think about ourselves and the world? If we start thinking about this, I think human beings have two very, very interesting capacities. One is the capacity of reflexivity. We are reflexive being. What does reflexive being mean? What is reflexivity? Reflexivity means the capacity of the human being to think about the given situation in many different ways. So the moment we are given a problem, our mind becomes active and tries to solve the problem. This problem solving capacity of human brain can be called as reflexive capacity. Take an example. We are locked in this room. Imagine we are locked in this room and there is no key, and we are told that this room cannot open. So there is no food inside. So what shall we do? We will need food to survive. So we will start looking for food. So how the mind will start working? The moment it is known to us that room is locked and we cannot go out, our mind will start looking around and trying to find out what to do to go out from the room, how to go out from the room. It will innovate new ideas, it will innovate new things to break the wall, to break the window, to break the door, or something will be done so that we can go out. It will start working faster and faster and faster the more we go into the crisis. Now this is the reflexive capacity, which does not work only in terms of crisis. It can also work if we do the second thing, that is the second capacity of the human mind, is abstraction. That we can abstract ourselves, we can think in abstraction. To think about US society, we do not need to be in US society. Our mind can start stimulating things, can start giving new kind of feelings of being in US, and that can generate certain kind of idea of what kind of society the US is. Or when we see the concrete things, and these concrete things can be reflected at certain level of ideas, and we abstract the idea. Even if the concrete thing is not there, no more there in front of us, we can work on that abstracted ideas. That makes us creative. So this reflexivity and the capacity to abstract, these two things are core capacity of human beings, and we think through them. When we start thinking on something, the mind focuses on that, it zooms out on that, and then it starts taking various layers of the relationship and start conceptualizing those layers of relationship and starts working on the network of the relationship. This is the human capacity, that is a creative capacity. Let me share a joke with you. A friend of mine who was asked that why he was absent from the university quite for some time, he said he was in hospital. So then people asked him that, well, why you were in hospital? He said, I had a problem, every summer I have some problem. So we asked him that, well, are you all right now? He said, no, what all right? There is a problem in my mind and they are treating my brain. This is the mind-body dilemma of dichotomy of Western philosophy, that our mind is something different than our body. Some people think that mind is nothing more than the brain, but The reality is that mind is something which is very abstract, which is located in brain probably. It's a consciousness, it's a software of the body. Now that is the level where we start thinking. Even the brain works on certain things, starts producing certain kind of signals, but the consciousness, the way the signal, the produced signal in the brain tries to generate certain kind of feeling and emotions and consciousness and ideas, that is something of a gray area for science and for biology to enter into. And the psychology, which is a very important discipline, has not been able to really very well find out what is the quality of this entity called mind. But we don't want to go into detail of this idea of the mind and body, or the mind and the brain, or the nature of the mind. What we are interested in is that how do we think? As I said, reflexivity and abstraction, these are two dimensions of mind through which we think. But as a living being, when we think, what do we do? How do we conceptualize the world outside and the world inside? The world is there within my body, the world is there within my consciousness, and the world is there outside my consciousness. I'm a part of that world, existing world, which is existing outside, and the outside world is also part of my internal world. But yet, these are the worlds through which we have to travel to see how much we can become conscious of these two worlds. How do we become conscious? How do we think about these two worlds? Let me pick up an example, or let me demonstrate through a kind of metaphor. Imagine there are series of half circles, and many half circles, or maybe you may say think of concentric circle. There is one center, but many circles around that, from smaller to the bigger. There are many circles. Now, in these circles, you imagine standing at the center, and from the center, you move towards the outer circle. And move towards the outer circle in one side, the left side. And then you move towards the outer circle in the right side. And imagine the circle left side is the outer world, and the circle right side is the inner world. So the point, the central point, is the point where we are existing. This is called ground zero. We are existing at that ground as body and mind together. This is where we are behaving at the moment, the way we are consciously working on something. Now the world outside, the more you move, the farther you go in terms of social organizations, the units of social organizations. So you are an individual. The next level of social organization is your family. The next level of social organization is your community, then your society, then your nation, your region, international region. Then you go to the globe, and then you go to the universe. So the series of entities, larger and larger and larger and larger, and outer and outer and outer and outer, the bigger cycle. If you go right side, you are at the center, talking about the world, being conscious about things around, behaving accordingly, and then you go in the inner world. The more you enter into your inner world, you will find there are many layers of your being. One layer is merely conscious about your everyday life. So the moment you meditate to enter into your consciousness, what will come to your mind is the existing world in which you exist at the ground zero. But the deeper you go, this outer world will gradually vanish from your thinking, and you will enter into the deeper layers of your consciousness, and then you will realize that you reach to the infinity, where you lose your consciousness. Either you go to the outer world or you go to the inner world. Ultimately, you reach to the infinity level of consciousness, infinity level of universe, where you merge your entity in the universal entities. And therefore, you will find that some people suggest that the scientists and the philosophers are doing the same thing. They are trying to know the ultimate reality, and when they reach to the infinity, they actually meet. And every scientist, big scientist, becomes a philosopher, and every philosopher starts talking about philosophy of science. So thinking of human beings progress in these two directions, depending what do you choose. And always you come back to the ground zero. Wherever you go, wherever you keep moving, you always return back to your ground zero, and the ground zero will be redefined all the time. The more you move towards upward, or more you move towards inward, you will find every movement, after every movement, you also come back to your ground zero. So you exist as human being. You exist as human being, being influenced by what layer have you accessed. So for instance, if I am a very selfish man, I have a body, my body is very selfish body, it wants to enjoy its being and the components that my body has. So my consciousness will be limited to my body. My body must be in comfort. My body must get whatever it is demanding, be it sexuality, be it food, be it anything. And I will behave according to the demands of my body. That is the animal level of existence. The animals, probably, we don't know about their consciousness, but it looks like as if they exist at that level, at the level of my body. But then you go beyond that. The more you go upward, more you lose the focus on your body. And then you start thinking of suffering. So you move to your family level. So what you do, you put your body into discomfort for the comfort of the family. That's the second layer. So there are some people who only keep thinking about their own family, nothing else. For them, the family is the most important thing. When you think about the family, definitely you go back to yourself and you redefine yourself as if you are living in a family where yourself has to sacrifice. And you enjoy that sacrifice also. It's not sacrifice which gives you pain. Even if there is a pain, you enjoy that. So your existence is at the level of the family. Then you suddenly move on and you go to the level of your community. So you start working for the community and you think, okay, my family may suffer for the benefit of my community, because your vision goes to the community and you identify problems of the community and you say that, look, my community is in problem. And you redefine yourself as a man of the community or women of the community. And so you work for the community. You become a whole-timer of a party. You become a whole-timer of a group. And you say that I have to work for this community because my community is extremely important, which means you identify yourself with the community. So your thinking gets limited to the community thinking. Then you move on from there and you can think of the nation. And you say, oh, no, my community is a small community in a bigger nation. The nation is in crisis. I have to solve the problem of the nation. So identify yourself as part of the nation, and then you negotiate between different communities. Say, don't fight among yourselves. You have to think of the nation. You may go beyond that. You think of the universe. No, this world should be nice world, and there should not be any war, because that destroys the world. That destroys the ecology of the world. And you can go beyond that. You can think, well, it's not a question of one nation, one world. It's a question of living being in this world. It's not a question of human beings only. It's a question of living beings. How do the living beings should live? How do you create a system in which every living being gets its due? So this is another layer of thinking. And then you can also go to the extent of thinking that, well, universe is in order. And we should never do anything that can destroy the order of the universe. That's not fair to do. So you have many layers of thinking upward. And at the level of universe, or you go even beyond that, you reach an abstraction. So as a thinker, as a thinking being, what is the layer of thinking you are achieving? It's something very crucial to define what kind of thinker you are. You can take a number of examples. I'll come to the examples a little later. But you can take an example of, say, Gandhi or Buddha or say, Tagore or Jesus Christ. So you have different kinds of thinkers who have thought about the universe, about the living beings, about the human beings. You also have another kind of thinkers, hardcore nationalists like Hitler, who would think that his nation was the supreme nation of the world, and that therefore it had right to rule everybody. So you have many kinds of thinkers, and they are defined by the layers they achieve in their consciousness, the level at which they pitch their consciousness. You go inward. When you go inward, you will find that your first layer of your consciousness is your relations around your workplace, all these relations in which you are living every day. If you transcend that, then you start thinking yourself as a human being, and gradually at the end of the day, you start thinking yourself as a living being, as a normal living being. And you go deeper and deeper, and you reach then to the level of universe. You say, I am a part of the universe. You have thinkers like that. You have Sri Aurobindo, or you have Ramakrishna Paramahansa, who have achieved that layer where they would not differentiate between their body and the non-living being outside. So your identification with the universe becomes complete. Then again you reach to the infinite level, and you say that, well, the whole universe, I'm existing in the universe, and the universe is existing within me. So either side you move, what layer of consciousness do you achieve, that will define what kind of thinker you are. Your thought process actually can have different layers simultaneously too, but then how quickly you jump from one layer to the other and how far can you go, that is important. And this jumping layers and existing at different layers will redefine you as a person, will redefine what you do in everyday life, whether you are living with the family, whether you are leaving the family and going outside, existing in a community, whether you are a whole-timer, political whole-timer, whether you are a philosopher, whether you are a philosopher whole-timer. I mean, all these things you will find will be defined by where are you located in this process. Let me take an example that how does this work in concrete situation. So I'm taking a very abstract idea of liberation, and I would like to ask you a question. What does liberation mean? What is liberation? We all keep talking of liberation. So what is liberation? Is liberation a universal concept? Is liberation dependent on the person who is defining the idea of liberation? I think the first section of our discussion will suggest that everybody will redefine his or her own idea of liberation depending on at what level is he or she existing. So liberation itself is expandable concept, a redefinable concept depending on the vantage point of the individual thinker. For instance, if we try to conceptualize, let me try to first give you the broadest possible idea of liberation, or let me give you the components of the idea of liberation, and then we can see how different people existing at the different layers of thinking define those components for themselves. Take these four, consider these four concepts of these four components of the idea of liberation. The first component is that of the natural world. We as human beings do need the natural world to survive. We need water, we need air, we need food, we need different kinds of supports from the nature what you call natural resources. You may call it natural resources or you may call it nature. So we are dependent on the nature. And in principle, anybody would agree with this point that all of us, all the living beings, would like to live, would like to survive physically. And for their survival, they are dependent on the nature. Therefore, each one of them have equal right to the nature. All of us, all the living beings, have equal right to nature. Equal right doesn't mean that everybody gets equally. Equal right means that we have right to appropriate things from nature which is needed for our survival. Beyond that, we should not try. Or should we try? That is a question we will discuss. But nobody has disagreement with this point that all of us are more or less having equal claim to, we have equal claim to nature. Equal claim depending on how much equality defined as your need, not your want. And you know the difference between need and the want. Want is artificially created, need is a genuine requirement of for your existence. So we have this, all of us do need this. Now, thinkers will reflect on this provision, how much we can take from the nature, depending on their location in the philosophical frame that I talked about. Where are they located? If somebody is located at a very individual level, then he would say, he or she would say that I need most, I don't bother whether other people get that or not. This is my requirement, this is my life, this is my body, and I must get maximum that I need. Not only need, they will also define their need into want into need and say that I need it because I want it. If you have somebody who thinks beyond that, thinks about the family, would say that, no, if we get something, we have to distribute in the family, and in the family, somebody who needs more, we have to give more to that person. If somebody is unable to work, we have to feed him. Even if he is not working, but his body needs it, if he is not well, he needs more than us. So we'll cut our shares and give it to him. If it goes beyond that, and you go to the community, then you start thinking, oh, in a community, there are rich and poor, and the poor must be supported. So you will go and ask for money from the rich and say that we are working for the poor. The CRY, for instance, CRY works for the children. What is the ground? That you go to the people and say that give us some money, you have some money, there are children who don't have any money. So therefore, we will serve for them. So that becomes a voluntary organization kind of thing which works for the community. You have then, if you think of the nation, then you say, okay, this is a natural resource of the nation as a whole. And even if there's an inequality, it doesn't matter. The national income has to grow. Even if it creates some inequality, even if some people have to leave their homelands, doesn't matter. The nation has to grow, therefore, we have to suffer. So we suffer for the growth of the nation. The nationalist thinkers, you think at the national level. You think at the international level, the level of the universe. And you make very different point. You say, doesn't matter whether your nation is rich or poor. The point is that if you pollute the universe too much, it will be a big problem, and the universe will not survive. Therefore, you should not get into war. Therefore, you should not get into armament race. You should come out from that, and you should try to think the way, the means through which the universe can survive. So this is about the natural resources. The second thing is the biological requirement of the body, and that's how we define ourselves, the biology of the body. And this also requires, my biology of the body requires certain food, of course, which we get from natural resources, but the biology of the body also requires my relation with other human beings. How do we enter into a relation with other human beings? What kind of relation can we enter? What relations are allowed relations, which are not allowed relations? All these things we have to define. And the thinkers of various level, you will find, they will define these things differently. If you are part of a family, you will say that, well, whatever is the biological requirement of everybody should be fulfilled. There's emotional attachment with the biological requirement. But if you are part of the community and you think with the community, then you will say, no, not my son should not be allowed to marry the girl from other community. The community will prohibit that marriage. And you have the half panchayat kind of thing, where you say, no, it's not allowed. So as a father, I want to save my child. So I would say, let her marry to anybody. It doesn't matter. What is important is her physical survival for me. But the community, if you think at the level of community, if you transcend your family, transcended your family level, and you are too much obsessed with your community, you will say, even if she is my daughter, and she belongs to this community from which I belong to, and therefore community rules must be acceptable to her. If you go to the higher level, at the universe level, then you will feel, it doesn't matter who marries whom. We all are human beings living in this universe. And our color, our caste, our community doesn't matter. We interact with each other as human beings. So you have these layers of thinking in your biological being also. Then you have the third layer, that of the laws of nature. How much do you know the laws of nature? How much deeper you go into the laws of nature, that will define your thought process. If you know the biology of the body very well, if you know the law that operates at the biological level of the body very well, then you take body as a biological being. If you go beyond that, you start thinking of the family, and you start thinking family as a unit. But if you raise your consciousness in the realm of knowledge, then you know that we are human beings living together to fulfill certain requirements. You go much beyond that, and then you see, okay, doesn't matter as a biological being, as a physical being, as a chemical being, this is going to be my behavior. Because this is what determined by my body. So you can re-examine yourself. The knowledge of the nature will define your existence in the world. Something is happening to your body. You know it's part of the natural process of the aging. So you're not emotional about it. You may not be emotional about the death, because you know the knowledge. You have the knowledge. I remember somebody giving an example that a great thinker, his son passed away, and this man went to one of the students and told him, look, my son is no more, but I have to go for my sadhana. Can you take care of his body? This is a layer of consciousness that you achieve when you go higher and higher in the thinking. So the body becomes your body. Life becomes a very simple thing. It's existing. It's a process of natural world. And the nature does behave in a particular way. So these things you take as natural to you. And the last thing, being conscious of your consciousness. You become conscious of your consciousness. You know the dynamics of the consciousness. You know, half the problem of the world is due to anger, the element of anger that human beings do have. And many philosophers have suggested that if you start analyzing your anger, half the problem will be over. Krishnamurti has suggested that when you get angry, you start thinking, why am I getting angry? Half the problem will be over. So, do you have capacity to become conscious of your consciousness or not? That also will be defined by at what layer are you existing. And therefore, you will be surprised to see that person like Buddha doesn't have anger. Why, as a human being, Buddha has no anger? What is the reason behind it? The reason behind it, this is that Buddha's level of thinking has gone much higher than the normal level of thinking, what we call ourselves, nation, state, family, etc., etc. So he thinks of the universe. For him, death doesn't matter. The famous story of talking to Angulimal. Buddha goes to talk to Angulimal. And Angulimal is, you know, that he was a killer. And he thought that the man who is standing in front of me will fear by seeing me. But he didn't fear. Why he didn't fear, that is important. He didn't fear because he took this, he had the knowledge of the consciousness. He knew what was the problem for Angulimal and what is the reason of my fear. So the fear is taken care of by his knowledge of his consciousness. So what kind of philosopher you are, what kind of thinker you are, will be defined by what is the level you think at. And the higher people think, the higher level they achieve, the larger things they can see, the bigger picture they can see. And the bigger picture, if you can see, then you can talk of the future possibilities much better. You capture the processes going on in society. You capture the long-term vision of society. You have the long-term vision of society. You may say, this is going to happen in this way. These are the possibilities of society. Now, if you agree with this point, that our thinking is a process which continuously grows, and it is possible that human beings start transcending these layers of thinking. The more you transcend the layer of thinking, the larger picture will start emerging to you. And the larger picture you have, you will be able to talk about more future possibilities. Now, if you want to categorize the thinkers today, who is doing what, you can put them in this grade and you can see that where are they located. Let me take some examples of the word. You know what is called classics? The classic text. Why some text becomes classic? And who is the author of the classic? Why the author is capable of producing the classic? And who is a philosopher? I think the author is capable of producing the classic because the author achieves that layer of thinking, a vision, where he looks at the bigger picture, the larger picture. And the larger picture, obviously, redefines the author's individual behavior, redefines the author's capacity to document that. And if he or she documents that larger picture, that document becomes classic document. That is the classic document. So if you take philosophers like Hobbes, Locke, Rousseau, Wittgenstein, Russell, Gandhi, these were the people who were able to see things, who were able to see bigger pictures in their own time. And since those times were, new times were emerging when Hobbes was writing or Locke was writing, they were looking at the picture which was true for next 400 to 500 years. They could see that vision. They could have that vision. You may have a philosopher who can be universal for, who can think beyond time. You may be a thinker who thinks within time. Depends what layer you achieve that of the thinking. The difference between social science and religion is that social science limits its thinking to the time, in the time and space. The philosophy doesn't limit its thinking in the time and space. It tries to transcend that barrier of time and space. It tries to. I'm not saying it transcends the barrier totally, but time and space ultimately is a limiting factor. But definitely, it goes beyond the immediate. And that's where one becomes philosopher, the other becomes social scientist. Social scientist tries to analyze the existing conditions and tries to find out the causality in the existing conditions and tries to explain the existing conditions. The philosopher tries to see beyond the point and captures the universal principles of thinking, of universe, of human behavior, and also becomes concerned about the normative elements of that. You have universal thinkers, you have very particular thinkers or national philosophers, but you have universal thinkers who doesn't think about the nation, thinks about the humanity as a whole and tries to save the humanity, try to suggest that for humanity's survival, following things are needed. That doesn't mean that that person is not located in the time and space. The person is located in the time and space, is reflecting on the time and space, is behaving in a particular way in the time and space, but the horizon of thinking is very big. And that horizon of thinking, as it is defined by the normative concerns, may convert the thinker into a universal thinker. So that is a way we think. That's how we transcend the layers of various kinds of thinking. And the more we go higher, the bigger picture we have, and the deeper we can penetrate. The more we go inside us, let me take another example. More we go inside us, we reach to the finer elements of human beings, which is universal human being, which is a species being. You have example of Ramakrishna Paramahans, who did not differentiate between animals and human beings and himself. Take example of Nietzsche. You know, when there was an episode that the horse of the cart was being beaten up, Nietzsche was very angry. He felt that he was feeling that pain. So when you start feeling the pain of the other living being, you start thinking at the universal level. So there are people who have gone inside oneself and have thought about the universe. People who have gone to the universal level. There are people who have thought outside the world and have gone to the universal level. Take for example Einstein was a scientist. You know, that when he was in Germany between the world wars, what he innovated was not being studied in England because they thought that it was German science. But very soon they realized there was nothing called German science or British science, but it was universal science. And what Einstein was talking about, the universal law of nature. And he was capable of thinking the universe and the human beings, and was saying that human beings will get this knowledge. It is very important for human beings to get this knowledge to make their life better. That was the level of thinking. So you have many layers of thinking, and you transcend these layers gradually, and you achieve new layers of thinking, and you come back to your living being, you as a living being, and you redefine yourself. At times that redefines your dress, at times that redefines your relationship, at times that redefines your imagination of the world and your imagination of the self. So things are redefined by that. So different kinds of thinkers, whether you are a social scientist, a philosopher, or a literary person, all this is defined by and conditioned by your existence at a particular level, your existence at a particular layer. That's how we can think about the thinking. And this is just the beginning of what you think about the thinking. I think thinking is a more complex thing. I think thinking is not an easy thing to do. And it is not so coherent that you get point one, two, three in a very coherent way. If you think about the thinking itself, it is a difficult thing to comprehend. And then there can be a kind of crowdsourcing on this. How do we think? And new century, I think, is obsessed with this idea that how do we think? We have to redefine how do we think. And therefore, people like Heidegger is becoming very, very important today. I think I'll stop here and I'll wait for some questions.
You well explained the how do we think. But point sometimes arise that either people are born with such a quality who can transcend all this layer and have a flair of thinking universally, or you can say, those who are put themselves in a boundary, you were suggesting that conditioning of the people that helps in the case of Buddha, or the even the case of we can say Gandhiji, in circumstances he confronted with the different situations and circumstances, and that molded him into that direction. So what you suggest, the elements, people are born with such elements, or the condition which are more prevalent, which make the people universally philosophical?
We don't know. I think this is something that we don't know, that whether we are born with this quality of thinking, or our mind is conditioned in a particular way by social reality to think in a particular way. I guess there is an element of being a particular kind of thinker also, probably. I'm not sure of it, but definitely there's a huge impact of the social reality on even the natural reality. Where are you located, in which geography you are located? I'm told that the geography of India has certain elements which can provoke human beings to think spiritually. I'm not sure of it, but I'm sure that human beings, though they have the agency and autonomy, and there must be something inbuilt in a person which makes them think in a particular way. But I also think that the conditions, the geographical, social, philosophical context redefines that, and it's a complex entity that emerges out of that, which is called thinking.
Okay, so it depends.
Yeah, it depends. I think it depends on how you are conditioned.
Okay, so suppose somebody want to chart out this path here you suggested from the ground zero to the different levels. So can one do it with the graduated way, or the one by one? Yeah, one can also jump to the other level.
You know, that is what they say when they say that we receive enlightenment. Generally, the standard thinking process that the modern science has talked about is in a graded way. Therefore, you have this system of classes, mm-hmm. that you first enter into KG, nursery, KG, then class 1, class 2, class 3, class 4, and you grow gradually. Mm-hmm. That's a normal idea.
Normal pattern. Yeah.
Normal pattern. But you also know that there are philosophers who were only 20 years of age, 15 years of age. Mm. Shankaracharya, I think, died at a very young age. Mm. Vivekananda died at a very young age. Mm. Many thinkers, I think, have defied what they were trained in. Mm. And they enter into an entirely new direction, not only in philosophy, but also you will find in social sciences and sciences. There's a physicist who became an economist. So I think that this graded idea is probably good for a normal thinking process.
Okay.
But the thinker, for them, I think these ordered things don't work. There's no pattern in that, I guess. And it is entirely possible that at a very young age you get that knack of thinking. How do we get it? I don't know. Mm-hmm. There's no reason to believe that there's a very conditioned circumstances in which you get that. Though, for instance, you know that about J.S. Mill and James Mill, mm-hmm. The father and the son. The father planned his son to become a philosopher, mm-hmm. and he trained him at a very young age, and J.S. Mill became philosopher at the age of 19, established mm-hmm. philosopher at the age of 19. Mm-hmm. But interestingly enough, he underwent deep depression at some age, 19 or 20. Mm. And when he came out from the depression, he produced many creative things, and in a different way. Mm-hmm. So many philosophers have this train that they have. There's a train that many philosophers have undergone deep depressions before they come out with something called enlightenment. For instance, Buddha, take example, he left home and went there, meditated. And then one day he got enlightenment, and that became the core of his whole philosophy. Mm-hmm. Gandhi, Erickson writes that Gandhi, when he was thrown out from the train, that was a moment of enlightenment for Gandhi. He thought that I have to turn the wheel, and he started getting into it. So some people, and he was a lawyer, so all graded training that Gandhi got, he unlearned everything to become an activist. So it's very difficult to say that if we can train human mind to think, it will become a philosopher or thinker. It is also entirely possible. This is called reflexive capacity of the human mind. We don't know in what condition they will reflect, in what ways, and what is the layer that he or she will achieve. There are ordinary people I have met who are extremely enlightened people, and some of them have told me that one day they suddenly realize that things have changed for, they suddenly realize something very new, and things have changed for them after some time. So enlightenment, I think, is a process of thinking, where you get that breakthrough in thinking. Take, for instance, Wittgenstein, the way Wittgenstein got the breakthrough, and he was an engineer, aeronautics engineer, but then he decided to become a philosopher, and he went to Russell and talked to him and wrote certain pages, and Russell said that this is the best thing I've read, and all those things. Okay. Then he left the university and went to a village and started staying in a village and talking to the children and teaching mathematics to the children. And that's how he then acquired his new idea. So this is something, I think you can become a social scientist by training. Mm-hmm. But to become a philosopher, the training is not, maybe a necessary condition, but may not be a sufficient condition. Because Ramakrishna Paramahansa was not even educated. He was just not educated, but he was a great philosopher, no doubt about it. Vivekananda was a physics graduate, but was a great philosopher. So I think that it's difficult to find the pattern in this. Okay. I mean, though most of the modern philosophers are university products, and they are trained in philosophy probably. But these philosophers are philosophizing within a limited domain. They have yet not been able to transcend that time frame.
Okay.
So the philosopher who will emerge, who will be a philosopher for the next time frame, I don't know how that person will emerge, from where that will emerge. So this is a very, very difficult question, I guess. Yeah.
Every year you meet with hundreds of students, newer scholars. Sometimes do you feel that he or she should be going in the direction of philosophy? He will be a good philosopher, he will be a good thinker, he will be a good professor or teacher. Sometimes does it happen to you?
Yeah, it happens many times, and we invest on them. We do locate certain people at a very young age. When I was teaching the undergraduate students, I could locate certain students that will, if they are given good support, they can go very high. But I must say that many of them had capacity to think in a very different way, in a very original way. But through the education system, we kill their thinking capacity also. That's my perception these days. That the way we try to produce human beings, the way we want to see them performing in the university, the way the performance is linked with your knowledge, and the way you are assumed to perform, that doesn't allow you to experiment with yourself. That doesn't allow you to experiment with knowledge. And therefore, what you do is, even if you have that capacity, sometimes what happens is that the capacity is finished off. You compromise with the capacity because you think that capacity will not make you excellent in the frame of the university. Mm-hmm. And that becomes a big problem for you. So I think that the university system probably is producing lot of thinking people and conditioning them to think, but I don't think that the next great philosopher will come out from the university system. If he does, or she does come out from the university system, that will be a surprise to me, because university systems are part of the systems of the existing knowledge tradition. It doesn't give you that autonomy to break that away, and even if you break away, you keep facing a lot of problems. Mm-hmm. So I think that one has to learn to think despite of the university. And somebody said very nicely that don't allow the university to interfere in your education. Okay. So that I think is the crucial element.
Okay. The last question I would like to ask you, because you said that in case of J.S. Mill and other philosopher or thinker, they undergo or severe depression or kind of things, disillusionment sort of thing. So what is your suggestion for aspiring thinker, those who are thinkers? What do you suggest how to save themselves from facing such a situation?
I don't think you need to save yourself. You may face that problem, but you should be aware that this problem is a problem of thinking. You should not think that it's a disease. You should nurture your depression. I think many good ideas you get during the depressions. And if you are depressed because of that, if it is a chemically induced depression, then you must get it treated. But if you think that you are depressed because you are thinking, then during that time, you must, I mean, depression also brings you to yourself and it allows you to think more creatively.
Okay.
So you should nurture that. You should use that time for your creative thinking, I think.
Kavi hai, I think, unhone kaha bhi hai, biyogi hoga pahla kavi, aah se nikla hoga.
Yes, it gives you creative, it is a very creative space also. It gives you creative potential also. It depends how do you use it.
So, well, friends, with this word, we conclude the lecture. I thank all of you for watching the lecture. And on my behalf, I thank Dr. M.N. Thakur for giving such an insightful lecture on this very topic. Thank you very much.